Let's pray.
And again, the message. Heavenly Father, I ask and pray that you would sustain your spirit here in this place through your word. Speak to us clearly. Show us that you are a trustworthy God. Show us that you are a God worth following. Show us that to follow you is to live life to its best. And not because you're going to reward us with material things, but because you're going to reward us with your presence, with who you are. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, before we start, can you turn to your neighbor? Okay, look at their face for a second. And I want you to think about your neighbor, the person you're looking at, okay? Would you trust them to catch you in a trust fall exercise?
you don't trust falling on concrete or marble for some reason, you might have a headache for a little bit. But for the most part, in life in general, when someone breaks your trust, it's not very fun at all. Right? In fact, usually it's pretty hurtful. It's pretty, and it can be not just hurtful, but it can be devastating if it's somebody that you love, or if it's somebody that you're really close to, or if it's somebody that you just thought was way more trustworthy than they ended up being. And so, when it comes to what it means to truly follow Jesus, right? Last week we said that, or 2 weeks ago when we started the series, we said you have to make a decision to follow Jesus. Right? Secondly, your decision to follow Jesus means that you're going to be teachable. That you're going to put yourself in a path where you can be taught by Jesus, you can be taught by God's word. Well, this morning, we want to talk about trust. A follower of Jesus trusts in him. And this is a big deal, because a lot of the reason why we don't want to go all the way with Jesus is because we don't fully trust him, right? In a trust fall analogy kind of way, we are falling from a very, very, very tall height, right? We're falling from a very, very tall height, and we're trusting Jesus to catch us in the end. And the question is, do you fully trust him to do that? Because if you don't, then it's going to be very hard to follow Jesus when he tells you to do hard things. Because that's one of the things that you'll learn about Jesus as you follow him, as you decide to go after him and learn from him, you'll come to understand that Jesus requires hard things of us. And so the question is, when those hard things come, do we trust him enough to follow through all the way? Okay? So let's go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 14. And I want to tell you a little bit about how the disciple interaction with Jesus helps us to understand this idea of trusting and what it takes to trust him. And we're going to be starting on verse 19, because that's the tail end of the story of where Jesus feeds the 5,000. And that serves as the context for what we're going to be reading. So, verse 19. Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass, and taking 5 loaves and 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing. Then he broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of the broken pieces left over. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. Okay? So right after Jesus feeds the 5,000, and it was probably closer to 20,000, right? So right after Jesus feeds them, look at what verse 22 says. Okay? So it says, immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. Okay? So right after he does this crazy, huge, huge miracle, right? I mean, because we've heard the story all the time, we don't understand the significance of it. But the idea is basically, Jesus comes and he feeds Dodger Stadium full, okay, of people, of food from almost nothing. 5 loaves, 2 fish. And everyone is filled. And basically what he does is, he then tells the disciples, now that you're done feeding everyone, get onto the boat and I want you to meet me on the other side. And what Jesus then does is he dismisses the crowds and tells them all to go home. Verse 23. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. Okay? So Jesus sends the disciples, Jesus sends the people home, and then he goes up to a mountain and he prays. Okay? We don't know what he prays, but we have some good ideas about what he's praying about as the story continues. It says, when evening came, he was there alone. Verse 24. But the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. Okay. So there is a storm brewing in the middle of the sea. Verse 25. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. Okay. So there was this huge storm that the disciples had to endure as they were coming into the other side of the sea. And it says that it was the fourth watch of the night when Jesus appears to them. Okay? The fourth watch of the night is about anywhere from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. So they've probably been fighting the storm for anywhere from 5 to 6 hours, okay? Which is a long time to be fighting a storm. Now, some of these guys are experienced fishermen. They know this lake, or they know the Sea of Galilee really well, and they know how to navigate this. But when you're struggling through a storm like this, it's really tiring. Okay? And then it says Jesus came to them, verse 25, walking on the sea. Okay, so Jesus is walking on the water. Verse 26, but when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It's a ghost, it is a ghost," and they cried out in fear. Okay? That makes sense. That's exactly how we would react if we saw somebody walking on water in the middle of a storm, right? We would just be freaking out. Verse 27, but immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid. Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid. And what's great about what Jesus says is he basically tells them, he identifies who he is. And the phrase he uses, "it is I," in the Greek, it can be translated also, "I am." Okay? And we know that those two words put together make up the Hebrew name for God, which is Yahweh. So Jesus tells the disciples, take heart, God's here, do not be afraid. Verse 28, and Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Okay? Now, this story is really interesting because we're not 100% sure of Peter's motivation. We don't know why exactly he decided to step out on the water. But what's interesting is in the book of Mark, which is the gospel written by one of Peter's disciples, this same story doesn't have the part about Peter walking on the water. It's actually omitted from the Mark version of the story. It's only in the Matthew version of the story. And so some people think that it's because it was an embarrassing story about Peter. Because we know what happens. Peter goes out into the water, and then he sees the waves, and he begins to sink. And so the question is, what motivated Peter to get onto the water? I don't think that it was that he was trying to show off, okay? Because Peter was definitely impulsive, but it doesn't make sense for him to want to show off in front of the other disciples in the middle of the storm, okay? That's not where people's minds generally tend to go. But here's what most people think, right? Most pastors think that the reason why Peter stepped out into the water is because that's where Christ was and he wanted to be with Christ. Okay? That's where Christ was and he wanted to be with Christ. So Peter says, "Jesus, if it's really you, command me to come to you on the water." Verse 29, he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took a hold of him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And then when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." So this story takes place pretty late in Jesus' ministry. Okay? So this is taking place a few weeks just before Jesus is actually going to go onto the cross. The later we get towards Jesus' ministry, the more Jesus reveals about himself and the more the disciples begin to recognize who he is. He's not just an incredible teacher. He's not just a miracle worker. He's not just a prophet. But now they're beginning to realize and understand that he is actually God. Okay? And the greater point of this story is simply that in the storms of life, okay, in the storms of life, when we go through various things, if we look to Christ, then we can survive those storms. Okay? I can tell you that the last 6 months for me and my family have been really difficult. For lots of reasons, right? And so for us to be able to look to Christ this entire time, I really believe that that's what sustained us through the entirety of our experiences the last couple months. And that's pretty easy to see. I think anybody reading this passage can come to those conclusions that this is the kind of God that we serve, this is the kind of Jesus that we serve. But here's the thing that I want you guys to catch, okay? It's verse 22. It's immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side. Okay. So Jesus purposely sends them into the storm. Jesus purposely sends them into the storm. And then what does Jesus do? Verse 23. After he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. What did he pray about? Most people believe that he prayed about the disciples, that they would weather this storm, that they would get through this storm, that they would find faith in being a part of this storm. And then Jesus calmly walks up to the boat to check upon them. Right? Actually, in the parallel passage in Mark, it says that Jesus was walking by, almost as if Jesus was just like, all right, they're okay. Right? He's just walking. And so the question is, wait, why does that happen? What's the point of that? Well, it's because your faith cannot grow without going through a storm. Right? Your faith is going to stay a baby kind of faith unless it is tested. And when your faith is tested, that's when you will know how much you trust in God. That it will be always true, and that will be true for all of your life. See, you will go through things as a student that you think are really tough, really difficult. And then when you become a college student, and then when you become a young adult, and then when you get married, and when you have kids, at every single one of those life stages, there will be challenges that come, and they will challenge your faith. So the question is, how do you have staying faith? How in the world do we weather all of these storms? Well, first of all, if you're a real Christian, you should know that Christ is praying for you. Right? The Bible tells us that Jesus Christ is our priest, and he intercedes for us. He prays for us. So when we go through a tough time, Christ is on our side. So that's first. Okay? But the second thing is, okay, let's look at Peter's life. Okay? So overall, look at Peter's life. So what he does is, Jesus tells him in the midst of the storm, it's me, God is here, do not be afraid. And what does Peter do? He says, if it's really you, command me to come to you on the water. So Peter's already being tested, but in the midst of the storm, what does he do? He wants to be with Christ. Right? And so when you go through a tough time, when you go through some form of trial, when you go through some sort of situation, do you run to Jesus first? Do you run to Jesus first? And then he says, what does Jesus say? Jesus invites them. He says, come. And so Peter got out of the water and walked on the water and came to Jesus. So when we talk about miracle work, when we talk about people who do incredible, amazing things, the phrase, he walked on water, it means basically doing the impossible, right? Egyptian hieroglyphics, right? You guys know the symbols for Egyptian hieroglyphics. It's said that the Egyptian symbol for the word impossible is actually 2 feet, and then there's water. So the Egyptian hieroglyphic for impossible is, you know, feet walking on water. And it's funny because that's exactly what Jesus does. But a lot of Christians miss this. Jesus wasn't the only human being to ever walk on water. So did Peter. Right? So what caused Peter to be able to have the same experience that Jesus did? It's because no matter what happened, Peter was willing to be where Jesus was. See, following Jesus means that you're going to be called to do impossible things. But if you're not willing to go all the way with Jesus, you will never get to see those things happen, right? A lot of you guys, this past summer, you went on mission trips. Some of you guys, a lot of you guys, were like, oh, I didn't really want to go in the beginning. I'm so glad I went. I experienced God. Oh, my gosh. Right? The idea is that you weren't sure of what God could do through you, and then all of a sudden you were placed into a mission context, and then all of a sudden you did stuff that you didn't think you were capable of. And you took a step back, and you were like, whoa, I can't believe God did that through me. God can do the impossible through you, but you have to be willing to go with Christ to do what Christ wants you to do. Okay? So Peter gets the experience of walking on water. Now, the question is, there's a basic sort of storyline in our culture, okay, that prevents a lot of you guys from really, truly following Jesus the way that I know you want to. And a part of that is because you doubt whether or not Jesus is God, or you doubt whether or not God actually exists. And the reason for that is because in our culture today, the narrative of evolution, the narrative of atheism, the narrative of believe whatever you want to believe, it's so saturating our culture that we just have an inherent distrust of God's word. Okay? This is why John Piper says, I am astonished at people who say they believe in God, but live as if happiness is found by giving him 2% of their attention. Whereas I'm astonished at people who say they believe in God, but live as if happiness is found by giving him 2% of their attention. Right? And in America, I think this is the way that we live. We're so busy with other things, even though so many of us say that we believe in God. And so the question is, do you actually believe in God? Right? Or is it because you have this nagging sense of doubt in the corner of your mind that you can't fully trust in God? That's the question. Okay? And so I want to address that just for a second. Okay? Because we got into a conversation about this on Wednesday, because as we were studying the Gospel Project, we were in Genesis 1. And a lot of the groups were having conversations about, I don't know whether or not this is actually true. Right? And I had multiple conversations with multiple people in multiple groups. And just over the years, right, I've discovered that a lot of you guys are very skeptical when it comes to Genesis chapter 1, when it comes to the storyline of how God created. Okay? Now, I'm not going to argue as to whether or not the earth is millions of years old or whether the earth is only 10,000 years old. I don't want to talk about that. What I do want to talk about is, what are the evidences for God? Okay? Why is it that I believe that God exists? It's not because the Bible says so, by the way. I don't think that's a good answer. Because the textbook says, your science textbook says that God doesn't exist. The Bible says that God does exist. Who's right and who's wrong? There has to be more. See, in my view, there is overwhelming evidence for God's existence. It's not just hinged on one thing. It's hinged on multiple things. Right? There's causal evidence. The fact that the universe has a cause. The universe has a beginning. Over the last couple decades, we've discovered that the universe is actually expanding. And the way that we discovered that was scientists pointed their telescopes into space, and they discovered that you can see infrared light. You can see infrared light and stretch out, and that means that the universe is expanding. And if the universe is expanding, time moving forward, then time moving backwards means the universe is shrinking. So you can eventually get to a point where the universe has a beginning. Okay? That's what we call causal evidence. Right? And then there's the fine-tuning of the universe. The idea that right now the universe is tuned in such a way that there can actually be life. Right? That physics is designed in such a way that if you put certain numbers together and if you put certain gravitational pulls and all that stuff, if you change those numbers slightly, the world as we know it doesn't exist. Human beings as we know it can't live on this world. Right? Then there's the evidence of design. Right? And I personally think this is the strongest evidence for why I believe in God, and it has to do with DNA. Because the more we discover about DNA, the more we see that DNA doesn't explain, so DNA actually helps to undo the notions of evolution that we have now. Because again, DNA is information. Okay? And when you take two strands of DNA and just kind of randomly jumble them together, you get mutation. And you know what mutation is? Mutation is cancer. Right? Evolution is the idea that creatures get better and better with each successive generation. But we discovered that if you just randomly mess with genes, they don't get better, they actually get worse and worse and worse, and often they just die. Because that's what cancer is. Cancer is DNA gone completely haywire, completely crazy. Right? So design is really, really compelling when it comes to, there's somebody out there who put this information together to create the distinct species that we have. And then there's moral evidence too. So not even just from a scientific perspective, from a moral perspective. Why is it that there's a standard of good and evil somewhere? Why is it that no matter which country you go to, stealing will always be wrong? Why is it that no matter where you go, lying will always be wrong? Why do we have universal morals? Where did that come from? Right? Evolution doesn't explain that. There's also transcendental arguments, right? Arguments as to why human beings believe that there's a supreme being. Why is it that kids are just bent that way? Why is it that we're all bent that way? Right? There's aesthetic experience. Why is it that when we go to the edge of somewhere amazing, like the Grand Canyon, or like to the beaches of Hawaii or something, we're just like, wow, why does it wow us? Right? Why does it amaze us? And why does something inside of us want to thank somebody when we see these things and it's amazingness and it's beauty? There's religious experience, right? How is it that millions upon millions of people actually have religious experiences and those actually mean something? And then there's ontological arguments like, why do we exist as opposed to not exist? Why are we here as opposed to not being here? So combine all of those things and it presents a pretty compelling case for God's existence. So if you're unsure of God's existence, and that's one of the reasons why you can't trust God, the question is, are you willing to put your mind to actually discover whether or not he exists? Are you willing to think about it? Are you willing to read about it? Are you willing to do your own research to find out whether or not it's actually true? And that's the legwork that we have to do. Now, we live in a culture that says, that has these sort of strawman ideas of Christianity and strawman ideas of God. And there are people that say, oh, I can't believe Christians would believe that God is, that God's the one that created all this stuff. It doesn't make any sense. Right? But there's a flip side to that too. How does evolutionary science make any sense in terms of explaining the origin of the universe? I'm not talking about how species mutate. I'm talking about the origin of the universe. Where did everything come from? How do you explain morality? How do you explain design and DNA and the complexity of certain systems? A couple weeks ago, when we were talking about the Love, Sex, and Marriage series, we were talking about just the fact that there's males and females. That can't be explained through evolution, because males and females require complex biological systems in order to have separate male and female species. Those don't just come about accidentally. They need each other in order to even exist to begin with. So all of this stuff, if you begin to layer the evidence upon evidence upon evidence upon evidence, it just doesn't make any sense. God being the creator and somebody designing all of this is the most logical explanation. But again, because of Romans 1, because people who are wise are actually their main fools, it breaks down in a way that doesn't make any sense. The other thing too is we assume that, like, if you go to college and if you go and you learn from a professor that they're smart and they have it all figured out, it's crazy to me, because just in the last couple weeks, there have been college professors who at the very beginning of the class, in their syllabus, okay, which is the list of things that you're going to be doing for the class, they'll hand out class rules. And one of the class rules is, which pronoun do you want to be called? Now, if you're a guy, what's the pronoun for a guy? He or him, right? What's the pronoun for a girl? She or her. They have additional pronouns. These professors have added pronouns to this list, right? So it's not just he, him, her, she, now it's zim and z, okay? And that's for somebody who doesn't want to be called a gender. Don't call me a man, don't call me a woman, call me a something else. I'm not a him, I'm not a her, I'm a z. But I have a question, what's the difference between a zim and a z? You're still differentiating between a male and a female, right? It doesn't make any sense. And this is at the highest level of our education in our country. Right? Imagine, okay, and you should be mad at this. What if you get to college, and you're paying for college, by the way. Most of you guys go to public school. You don't pay for public school while your parents pay for taxes. That's a whole different thing. Most of you guys don't pay, right? So when you get to college, you pay for your college classes, and the professor who you're paying $5,000-$6,000 per credit for is like, should I call you Zim or Z? And it's shocking, because actually one of our students is going to a school where a professor did that. I was like, well, this is actually happening. I thought I was just reading about this in the news. So, no, but it's happening all over the country. Why is it happening? Because our minds have failed, right? Our minds cannot understand language anymore. We question everything. C.S. Lewis says, if you question everything, if you see through everything, you eventually see nothing. Imagine if the entire world was made out of glass. Would you be able to see anything? No, because you see through everything, so eventually you see nothing. So we've educated ourselves into stupidity. That's what we're doing. And we're calling that education, we're calling that smart, we're saying that that's the pursuit of knowledge. But the idea is, if God's absent from that, that's where this all goes. So unless there's a God, unless there's somebody who's saying, this is how the world works, this is what we should believe, this is how I've created things, none of this makes sense. This world, this universe makes no sense. And so I want to end with this. There are storms in people's lives regardless of whether or not Jesus is around. And people forget that all the time. There are storms in people's lives whether or not Jesus is there. And so the question is, for the person that has Christ, they have someone to run to in the storm. For the person that does not have Christ, there's nowhere to go. There's depression, there's despair, that's all they have, we need. But for the Christian, we have Jesus that we can run to. J.D. Greer says this, he says, faith leads you through difficulty, not ironically. That's what Jesus did for Peter. That's what Jesus did for his disciples. He led them through it. He sent them into the storm, and then he came to show them who he really is. That's the Christian experience. That's the Christian walk. And so the question is, are you willing to trust this God? Who would test your faith? Who would lead you through difficulty, but who would make sure that you come out on the other side? And I don't know about you, but regardless of whether or not I believe in God, there's going to be things that are difficult. There's going to be trials. There's going to be pain. There's going to be suffering. And it makes no sense to me to have a worldview that can't explain any of that stuff, where all the suffering is meaningless. All of the pain is meaningless. Instead, I want to lean and I want to set my mind on the things that I know are true. And the Bible shows me with absolute proof that Jesus is the Son of God, and he's told me how to make meaning out of my suffering, how to make meaning out of my pain. And I know that when I follow him and I trust him fully, I will get through all of it. And that's what we need. That's the God that we need. That's the God that we serve. I'm going to ask you to close your eyes. I want to read to you Isaiah 43, verses 2 through 3 as we close. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. And verse 2 says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, and the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. God in Isaiah does not say, if you walk through the water, if you pass through the fire. He says, when you do these things, when these things come, he says, I will be with you. You shall not be overcome. You shall not be burned. You shall not be overwhelmed. That's the God that we serve. Are you willing to trust him? You guys, at the beginning of this school year, you have a job as students, you have a job as sons and daughters, you have a job as brothers and sisters, you have club responsibilities, you have after-school responsibilities, you have sports stuff to do, you have music stuff to do, you have careers to think about as you stress out about your tests that you have to take, and the colleges that you have to apply for, and all of these things are coming down the road, and in your life, this is intense for you. And the question is, are you going to go through it alone? Are you going to go through it without any meaning other than maybe worldly success or worldly material things at the end of it? Or are you going to go through this with the God of the universe who has a plan for you? Are you going to go through this with the God of the universe who sent his son Jesus to die for you, die for your sins, put his life on the cross? I don't know about you, but the alternate makes no sense to me. And I fully want to fall into the arms of my Savior, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you that you are a God who is trustworthy. We praise you and we thank you that you are a God who served us first before asking us to do anything. And that's so incredible and so gracious and so generous. God, we want to continue to love you and worship you. And we want to thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. Help us to live this week knowing that you are a God that we can trust with our lives. In Jesus' name.